Dear students, today let me explain the electromagnetic theory and Maxwell's field equations. Electromagnetic theory, which covers the basic principles of electromagnetism, the experimental basis for the theories predicted in electromagnetism, electrostatics, magnetic fields of steady currents, means magnetic field produced by steady currents, electromagnetic induction, Maxwell's equations, electromagnetic waves, magnetic properties of the matter, electric properties of matter, conservation of laws, all those things, they come under this electromagnetic theory. This theory is mainly based on a set of equations given by Maxwell, James Clerk Maxwell. These equations are known as Maxwell's field equations. There are four field equations. The first equation, which represents Gauss's law in electrostatics, or which is the mathematical expression or mathematical form for Gauss's law in electrostatics. Second equation, which explains, or it is connected with the magnetic field, and it explains the absence of magnetic monopoles. Third equation explains Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction, and the fourth one explains Ampere's circuital law. Before considering these Maxwell's field equations, let us consider an equation called equation of continuity, which explains the conservation of charge. This equation of continuity, it is a mathematical form of law of conservation of charge. What is conservation of charge? What it says? The total charge contained in an isolated system, it always remains constant. Charges neither be created nor be destroyed. We cannot add a charge to the system new, or you cannot remove the charge from the system. Total charge contained in that isolated system remains constant. The mathematical form of this law is equation of continuity. For this, consider a closed surface S enclosing volume V. Here, let me consider a point. Here, the surface is charged 1. Let Q be the total charge on this closed surface. Let rho be the charge density. Charge density means charge per unit volume. It is denoted as rho. Charge per unit volume, Q by V. That is charge density. And at this point, let V be the velocity of the charge. Small v, let it represent velocity of the charge. Rho is charge density. Now, let us define current density. Current density denoted as J, a vector quantity, defined as current per unit area of cross section. Current flowing in a conductor of unit area of cross section is the current density. Or I by A, what is I? Q by T. So this is Q by TA. Or you can write it as, what is A? Area nothing but volume by length. If you consider the conductor of length L of volume V, then A is nothing but V by L. So that this J becomes, see, rearrange this, Q by V, here capital V, volume, not velocity, volume into L by T. L by T, L is length of the conductor, T time, it's nothing but distance traveled by the charge in unit time, can be taken as velocity of the charge. So that current density is also given by rho V. What is rho? Charge per unit volume. Thus, current density is either I by A or rho into V. I current, A area of cross section, here rho charge density, charge per unit volume, V the velocity. See, this is how we get, this is the way how we get J as rho into V. Now, here we have the closed surface. There's a charge. Flow of charges constitutes current. Then, the current flux, the flux of current, outward from the surface. It is given by the surface integral of the current. Or current or current density. The surface integral of current density over this closed surface, yes, gives the flux of current from the surface. So, I can be written as surface integral of J vector dot ds vector. You know the definition about the surface integral. Here we consider a small area ds, flux through that area is J ds, total flux over the entire surface. surface integral. Now, the current emerging, current moving out from the surface, the meaning is current outflow, the flux of current coming out from the surface, that means decreasing charge inside the surface. That is equivalent to decrease of charge, negative of decrease of charge. This outward current, flux of current, is equivalent to decrease of the charge minus decrease of charge per in unit time. So we write current as minus delta Q by delta T. This is rate of change of charge, which is negative. Flux outward means the rate of change of charge there decreases. Decrease in charge in unit time, but it is taking in the opposite direction as that of the flow of current. So I is minus delta Q by delta T. Now here we take this Q. What is Q? The total charge contained in the entire surface S. If rho is the charge density, what is it? Charge per unit volume. If you consider the volume dV of that small surface dS, dV, volume of the small surface dS, then rho dV gives the total charge contained in the volume dV. Do you get? Rho dV gives total charge contained in that volume dV. So that total charge in the entire volume V, nothing but volume integral. So we write Q in terms of the volume integral like this. So Q, volume integral of rho dV. Therefore, substituting Q here, we get I as minus volume integral of delta by delta T of rho dV. Delta by delta T of Q is taken as rho dV. Or it is minus, take it, integral of delta rho by delta T dV. Let the equation be 2. Now, here we have two expressions for I. Both 1 and 2 gave the expressions for I. Therefore, equating 1 and 2, we get this equal to this. Equate them. And here we have in the left-hand side surface integral. Right-hand side we have volume integral. So now, here we apply Gauss divergence theorem. And what's the use of Gauss divergence theorem? Using that we can convert surface integral into volume integral. So here we can make the integral same, homogeneity, to bring the homogeneity. What we do? We apply Gauss divergence theorem. According to Gauss divergence theorem, surface integral of the given vector is equal to, what is it? Volume integral of divergence of that vector. Apply that. So now this becomes volume integral of divergence of D. What is divergence? Del dot. Divergence means del dot that vector. So that this one becomes, as per Gauss theorem, this one equal to volume integral of del dot J. See, these things we discussed in the previous class or previous video. Therefore, substituting this as this, we get this equal to this. Or take this term to the left hand side, simplify. You get del dot J plus delta rho by delta T equal to 0. And this equation is called the equation of continuity. And this explains the conservation of charge. This is about equation of continuity. Now, let me explain one more topic. It is the dielectrics. Dielectrics or dielectric materials. Dielectric materials are the materials which are electric insulators. Dielectric materials are electric insulators. By applying an external electric field, these materials, they can be polarized. The materials can be polarized. Polarizing means it is possible to create charges there inside this material by applying an electric field. When this material is placed in the electric field, the electric charges, they do not flow through the material, but they shift slightly from their equilibrium position. They shift slightly from their equilibrium position, thereby causing the electric polarization. What is polarization? Let us discuss later. So the external field causes the polarization of this the charges or polarization of the dipoles in the dielectric material. This creates an internal electric field. Due to polarization, an internal electric field is created, and this reduces the overall field within the dielectric itself. And in dielectrics, there are two types of molecules. They are polar molecules and non-polar molecules. The molecules of the given dielectric material may be polar or may be non-polar. Polar means polar molecules are the molecules in which the center of positive and negative charges, they do not coincide. In the molecule, the positive and negative charges, their centers, they do not coincide. See, as you see here, example is HCl. The centers of positive and negative charges, they do not coincide. Such a molecule is called a polar molecule. And in the normal state, that means in the absence of the external field, the dipoles, they possess, even though they possess dipole moment. When do they possess dipole moment? When the centers are separated, they possess dipole moment. The dipole moment is always the product of charge of one of the, or product of charge and the separation between the centers of the charges. That gives the dipole moment. So in the absence of the external field, polar molecules, they possess dipole moment, but they orient in random directions. They align in random directions, see as shown in this diagram. Their alignment will be in the random direction so that net dipole moment possessed by that dielectric material is zero. Net dipole moment possessed by the dielectric material, it will be zero. When the electric field applied, then the dipoles in the material, they start aligning in the direction of the applied field. They align themselves in the direction of the applied field so that in the presence of the applied field, this dielectric material, it having polar molecules, which acquires net dipole moment. When the field is applied, it acquires net dipole moment. In that case, we say that the dipole or the dielectric is polarized. The dielectric is said to be polarized in the presence of the external applied field. The second type, non-polar molecules. Here, the centers of positive and negative charges, they coincide. The centers of negative and positive charges, they coincide, means they overlap. Such a molecule is called non-polar. See, these are the examples. And now let us see what is polarization. See, in a dipole, suppose polar molecules, say, dielectric having polar molecules. The charges are separated a little. The centers, are they do not coincide, means there is separation between positive and negative charge. So this is a dipole, say, separated by distance r. Now, the dipole moment of this dipole given by product of Q and R, Q charge, R separation. This gives the dipole moment. Now, the dipole moment acquired by the material per unit volume, it is called as polarization. Dipole moment acquired per unit volume called polarization, denoted by P. And the expression is N by V Q R. See here, N by V gives number of charges per unit volume. See, N total charges, V the total volume, then N by V number of charges per unit volume. So this is the dipole moment acquired per unit volume. This gives dipole moment acquired per unit volume, and this is called as polarization. And in the electric field, this polarization P varies directly as the strength of the electric field. That is, P vector equal to a constant multiple of E. What is E? Strength of the applied electric field. Here the constants epsilon naught and chi. This is read as chi. The symbol is chi. Epsilon naught, nothing but permittivity of free space. It is permittivity of free space, 8.851 into 10 power minus 12 SI units. Chi, called known as electric susceptibility. Chi is called electric susceptibility of that material, that dielectric material. This chi, that of a material, that electric susceptibility, which is the measure of how easily that material can be polarized in the presence of an external electric field. How easily the given material can be polarized, it is measured by that constant called electric susceptibility. This is about the polarization of the dielectric material or the polar molecules. Now, let us consider Maxwell's field equations. In that, the first equation is divergence of D is equal to rho, or del dot D is equal to rho. The symbols have their own representations. D, the vector D represents displacement vector, electric displacement vector. D is called electric displacement vector. What actually it is, let us discuss later. Rho represents the charge per unit volume or charge density. Rho is charge density. So first equation is del dot D is rho. And this equation explains Gauss's law in electrostatics. The Gauss theorem or Gauss law in electrostatics, the statement is the total electric flux through a closed surface is always equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the total charge enclosed by the surface. This is Gauss theorem in electrostatics. Can be represented like this. Phi equal to 1 by epsilon naught into Q. This is Gauss theorem in electrostatics. Phi, the electric flux from the closed surface enclosing charge Q. And using this Gauss theorem, let us find out, or let us get the expression del dot D is equal to rho. For this, consider a dielectric material. Consider a dielectric material placed in an electric field E. And as we discussed, the dielectric gets polarized in this electric field E. We consider a closed surface. See, this is the closed surface of the dielectric material in the electric field. These are the dipoles which are polarized in the electric field. Here, we take one surface, a dipole of area say ds, direction of electric field, and this is the normal in the direction, normal to the surface ds, n cap normal to the surface ds. Let rho be the charge density of this dielectric material due to free charges. See, free charges very less there still. Let us consider rho, the charge density due to free charges, and after polarization in the electric field, let rho suffix p, let it be the charge density due to polarization. So here, that Gauss theorem, total flux equal to 1 by epsilon naught times total charge, that can be written as, that becomes this in this case. Total flux. Actually, what is total flux? Flux of the electric field. Nothing but surface integral of E vector dot ds vector gives the total flux of electric field equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the total charge. Total charge due to free charges as well as polarized charges, and total charge due to free charges, it is volume integral of rho dv. Total charge due to polarized charges, nothing but volume integral of rho p dv. So that this is the Gauss expression. Now, here polarization takes place. Large number of dipoles are created. Here, consider the small element of area ds. This one. Now, let us find out the charge carried across this ds. When polarization takes place, electric polarization takes place, what is the amount of charge carried across the whole surface? That we have to find out. For this, we consider that small area ds. First, find out the charge crossed across that area. To find out that, the charge carried across that area ds is nothing but charge contained in the volume dv. The volume dv corresponding to this. Charge contained in this volume dv is equal to charge enclosed by that volume v, nothing but charge enclosed by an imaginary cylinder. Just imagine a cylinder like with the base area ds and a height equal to r vector. Now, the charge contained in this volume dv equal to charge enclosed in this cylinder of base area ds and height r vector dot n cap. Now, and if n is the number of dipoles in the volume v, then charge carried across this area ds, it can be taken as n by vq ds into r vector dot n cap. See, this point, this part gives the volume. This is total charge per unit volume. Number of charge per unit volume into the charge, total charge per unit volume into the total volume. So that this gives the total charge carried across that volume corresponding to this area ds. Total charge carried across the volume dv is given by this. Just rearrangement, n by vq r vector dot, club the ds with n cap, ds n cap can be taken as ds vector. So that we have this charge carried equal to this one. And by definition, n by vq r vector, this part is nothing but p vector. See, already we have seen in polarization, this expression is nothing but p vector. So that the charge carried across the area ds given by p vector dot ds vector. What is p vector? Polarization. Polarization is dipole moment per unit volume. Dipole moment per unit volume. See, nqr, dipole moment per unit volume. So we have p vector dot ds vector. This is charge carried across ds. Therefore, total charge carried across the whole surface. How do you get? Surface integral of this expression. This is total charge carried across the surface due to polarization. Now, when the charges are carried across this surface, now we have the charge density due to the polarization. We took it as integration of rho p dv. The charge density due to polarization is volume integral of rho p dv. Here, as charges are carried across the surface, the charges left behind there in the region is minus integration of rho p dv. The charges left behind after charges moving out from the surface equal to negative. The directions are opposite. So, minus integration of rho p dv. So that we equate the surface integral to this. These two are equal and opposite. That's all. One is moving outward, other one is remaining there. These are equal and opposite. So, this is equal to this. Now, we have, see, the previous expression, Gauss theorem. In this Gauss theorem, substitute the expression for integration of rho p dv. That integration rho p dv is nothing but this, but minus. So, by substituting integration rho p dv over v as minus this, we get this. Or, here, take this epsilon naught to the left hand side. Then, this equal to this. Just epsilon naught is common for both the terms. So, take it to the left hand side, club it with e, you get this. Or, now, these two both are surface integrals. So, take this term to the left hand side. Then, you get surface integral of epsilon naught e plus p vector dot ds vector equal to this. Here, this epsilon naught e plus p is taken as d, known as the displacement vector, electric displacement vector. So that left hand side is integration of d vector dot ds equal to this. So here we have surface integral, here it is volume integral. Now what we do? For the homogeneity of integration, we convert this surface into volume. How? By applying Gauss theorem. So according to Gauss theorem, surface integral of this equal to volume integral of divergence of D. So that this becomes volume integral of divergence of D. What is divergence? Del dot. divergence means del dot. So this becomes del dot d dv. Therefore, this equal to this. Both are volume integrals, so they're integrands. They can be equated thus. Del dot d equal to rho. This is how we get the first equation by using, or it is a mathematical form of that Gauss's statement, Gauss's theorem in electrostatics. That mathematical, that form is reduced to this. This is Maxwell's first field equation. And see here, d is this, epsilon naught e plus p. Or you can write it as epsilon naught, taking epsilon naught common, e vector plus p vector by epsilon naught. Or epsilon naught into e vector plus. What is p vector? Epsilon naught chi e vector. Already in the previous discussion, we have seen this. So epsilon naught gets cancelled. So what's remaining? Epsilon naught e vector into 1 plus chi. See, that is epsilon naught into this 1 plus chi is taken as epsilon r. This epsilon r is called relative permittivity of relative permittivity of the medium. Epsilon r is called relative permittivity of that dielectric medium. What is epsilon r? 1 plus chi. So that our d vector is epsilon naught epsilon r e vector. It's also written as epsilon e vector. D vector is written as epsilon e vector. You can write it as epsilon e vector. D vector is epsilon e vector, where epsilon is epsilon naught epsilon r. Epsilon naught is permittivity of free space. Epsilon r, relative permittivity of this medium. Then epsilon is epsilon naught into epsilon r, absolute permittivity, epsilon naught into epsilon r. For free space, epsilon r is 1. For free space, epsilon r is 1, so that epsilon equal to epsilon naught for free space. Then del dot d equal to rho implies del dot epsilon e is rho, or del dot e equal to rho by epsilon naught. So del dot d is rho, or del dot e is rho by epsilon. Now, the physical significance of this equation, del dot d equal to rho, what it says, this equation here, del dot, it's a dot product. So, and del is the operator depends on space coordinates, x, y, z, is it not? And del independent of time. So this equation says that it's a steady state equation independent of time. Depends only on space coordinates, del only. No t there. One more thing is, according to this equation, what it says, del dot d equal to rho. Del dot d, divergence of d or divergence of e. Look at the both, divergence of e or divergence of d. Divergence of any vector is always a scalar. Divergence of a vector field is always a scalar. So it says that charge density is always a scalar. Now, one more thing is, the flux of the electric lines of force. What it says? Del dot d equal to rho, or del dot e equal to rho by epsilon. What it says? The flux of electric lines of force depends on the charge density. More is the charge density, more will be the flux. And it also says that the positive charge always acts like the source. Negative charge always acts like a sink for electric lines of force. I had explained these things in the previous class. In case of divergence, positive charge, flux lines are moving outward. They are diverging. So positive charge acts like a source. In case of negative charge, flux lines are moving towards the point, or the point acts like the sink for this electric lines of force. This is about the physical significance of this first equation. With this, I stop here. Second equation, let us consider in the next class.